Good morning. Welcome to our church this morning, the Methodist Church. Today is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And the people said, Amen. The opening prayer this morning, the announcements, of course, are in our bulletin. And I don't know if we, we do have some more. Remind the congregation that loaves and dishes meal is tomorrow night at 5:00. Please plan to attend and invite others to come with you. I don't know how many we had last month, but how many?
40.
So, yeah, let's try to get more than that. And please invite others to come with you. Okay, the opening prayer this morning. Send forth your Spirit, O God. Be with us in our worship, that it may be pleasing to you. Dwell among us, even though your presence will startle and unsettle us. Grant us your peace, we pray, as your justice and your love pour down upon the world. Please stand and join in the call to worship. Beloved, pay attention. Do you see dry bones surround us? In our communities, workplaces, schools, and beyond, where people yearn for love, dignity, and provision, these bones emerge. We ask.
Will these bones live?
Listen closely. Many of us carry dry bones within, rattling in our hearts, dreams fading, talents untapped, hopes neglected, loneliness eroding connections. We question. Feel it. The Holy Spirit moves among us, breathing love, provision, and connection. Never ceasing, the Spirit assures.
These bones will live.
Sense it. God continually restores us through dreams of abundance, visions of cooperation, and diverse voices proclaiming and receiving good news. The Spirit rejuvenates us, affirming. Thanks be to God. Hymn of Praise is on page 334, Sweet, Sweet Spirit. Remain standing for the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered unto Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please pass the peace as you feel comfortable and greet your neighbor.
Good morning, and welcome, and we're glad you're with us. If you're new with us this morning, we do have visitor cards in the back of the pews. If you would please sign one. Please welcome our guests who are with us today, and I hope I can meet you after the service. Remember again, as Kitty pointed out, tomorrow is our loaves and dishes meal. Reservations are not required, but they do help us so that we can plan, especially since we're in the beginning stages of getting this ministry started and moving. So if you do plan to come, if you can please call the office, that'll give us a rough number of how many people to expect. If you don't reserve and your time comes free, you can still come. But if you just know, that would help us out a lot. We have our prayer lists that are in your bulletins. As you can see, they're getting quite long. We have a lot of people who need prayer. Do we have those that we'd like to lift up especially this morning, or any updates or anything on this prayer list, any additions to be made? If you do have an addition to be made, again, there's a prayer card in the back of your pews. If you could please fill that out just so we can put it on the list to get the spelling correct. Do we have those that we'd like to share, any joys or concerns this morning? Very quiet bunch for Pentecost. All right, I'm not seeing any. I do know. Take this list home with you, though, and realize that this is just a drop in the bucket of those around the world that need our prayers. Can we come before God? Lord, on this Pentecost morning, we come, we gather, and we pray for, and yet we even expect, a fresh outpouring of your Spirit. Speak to our hearts, speak to our minds, move within us, in our bodies, in our souls, that we're made new, that we hear your word in a new and refreshing way, that those stories that we've heard for so long suddenly stir within us and make even new sense. Let your Spirit be with us during this time and even as we leave and the rest of our days, that we sense your calling in our lives, that we find the things you would have us do, that you give us the rest and the rejuvenation that we need. Fill us with that Spirit, not so that we can hoard onto it, but so that we can spread it everywhere we go. Just like tongues of fire came upon the apostles, let our words and our presence be a reflection of that as we go into a world that needs you. Let our actions, our words, and how people see us spread your love and spread your message of salvation when we know we're doing it, and even at times when we're not sure what we're doing, and yet you're acting through us. Lord, as we give you thanks, we also ask for your intercession. We ask for your love. We ask for your healing. We ask for your peace. For those names which are on our prayer list, for the names that are on prayer lists in places all around the world, for names that are mentioned in our hearts and in the hearts of your people everywhere, for ourselves, for situations around the world where there isn't peace, where there isn't love, where there isn't health. We ask for your spirit, your love, your healing to touch all of these. Lord, there are things we will remember later. There are things we don't speak of and yet are known by you. There are situations which only you know about and we ourselves do not. And so we pray, Lord, in your goodness and your mercy, that you hear our prayers, both the spoken and the unspoken. Look upon us and forgive us our sins. We've done the things which have displeased you, and we've left undone the things that we should have done. Guide us not only to ask for forgiveness, but guide us to repent, to turn away from those things, and turn to you in all aspects of our lives. Help us to fully cling on to you as our Savior and as our Lord. This we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught all of us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Could the ushers please come forward as we collect our tithes and our offerings?
Heavenly Father, as we gather on this Pentecost Sunday, we are reminded of the transformative power of your Spirit, breathing life into dry bones and igniting the hearts of your people, just as you enlivened the early church with the wind and fire of your presence. Empower us to prophesy life into the brokenness of the world. May our offerings today be a testament of our faith in your promise of renewal and restoration. Amen. The hymn of preparation is 393, Spirit of the Living God.
Will you pray with me the prayer for illumination? Let us pray this together. Lord, on this Pentecost, we praise you for the Holy Spirit, the flame that ignites our hearts and guides our way. Grant us the grace to embrace your word with faith and love, and empower us to walk boldly on the path you have laid before us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture today is the famous Pentecost story. We hear this every year on this date. And so again, we'll hear from Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. Hear now these words. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all of these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own language, we hear them speaking about God's great deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea, and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. even upon my slaves, both men and women. In those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. If you read our newsletter this week, you read my article, hopefully, where I talked about how in my first career I was a music teacher. And in several of those years, I taught fourth and fifth grade orchestra. You can imagine what the sounds were at the beginning of the year. Young kids, 10, 11, 9, somewhere around that age, coming with musical instruments. Musical, I put in quotes at the beginning. Musical instruments, they come and they want to learn the fundamentals of what it means to play a song and play these instruments in a group. The noises can be quite sharp and ear-piercing, and I'm being very gentle about that. I suggest if you're ever a beginning music teacher that at least for the first few weeks of school, you carry with you some Advil, Tylenol, and a pair of earplugs. Not because the kids aren't trying, not because they don't want to do well, but anytime you put something in the hands of a child as they begin, you can imagine what the sounds are. Maybe you remember your own kids picking up an instrument. Weren't those first few weeks and months? What's a good word to put it? Painful? You said it, not me. But it is painful. Those first few weeks and months are just almost torturous to go through. But then eventually something strange happens. Something strange, and it's almost hard to explain how this even happens. At some point, these kids realize that these are actual musical instruments that can play actual songs. These are actual musical instruments that can play actual music rather than just noisemakers. So they go from these disturbing squeaks and squeals and crunches and pops and other sounds that you don't think come out of a violin or a cello or a viola. They suddenly realize, I can play a recognizable song. I liken it to Pentecost because they finally realize, I'm not just running a bow across the strings of an instrument. I'm not just blowing into an instrument and pressing buttons. No, what I'm really doing is doing this and making music. I liken it to Pentecost because they finally realize there's a spirit to the music. And that's how we can compare that to that first Pentecost. You see, the disciples were out and about, and they're trying to spread the gospel message. As we got to our scripture today, they're in the house, wherever the house was. We just know it was in Jerusalem. And they're trying to spread this gospel message. They realize that there's something about Jesus that saves us as humans. And yet, we have to wonder, how do you make sense when you're talking about God, a man, who died and then rose again? Can you imagine if somebody said that to you for the first time, that this person you knew died and suddenly they rose again? How do you make that make sense to the masses? To the people hearing it, to many hearing it, I'm sure it sounded like nonsense, or if you will, noise. To the people hearing it, it made very little sense. Oh, some jumped on the bandwagon, but it just made no sense because no one had ever seen this before. When you're dead, you're dead. You don't rise again. And how do we explain that it happened to Jesus? Remember, go back to the Easter story. Even those that were there that day didn't necessarily believe their own eyes. And so how do we explain it a few months later, 50 days later? But on that day, it was something different. On that first Pentecost day, something completely different happened. Suddenly, there was a violent wind. Have you ever been somewhere and the wind just starts to blow and you're like, God, you have my attention? Have you ever been at a family picnic or just been sitting outside and the wind starts blowing through the trees and suddenly God has your full attention? I don't know if it's God's plan to get your attention that moment, but something about wind just sucks us in and makes us realize that something in nature is going on. And if that wasn't enough, suddenly these tongues of fire came down. These things that looked like little fireballs just came down out of the sky and they rested over the head of the apostles. The people were like, God, you got my attention now. And then if that wasn't enough, if the wind wasn't enough, if the tongues of fire wasn't enough, suddenly people could hear this gospel message in their own language. You see, Jerusalem at the time was a big trading port between Asia and Africa and parts of the Middle East. It was a big trading center, and so you would have people of all nationalities who were there. In our scripture, they were there for religious reasons too, to go to the temple and to worship. You had Jews of different nations who spoke different languages, and suddenly now they're hearing the Jesus story in their own language. They said, are these not Galileans? In other words, why are they speaking my language? Why are they speaking English? Why are they speaking Russian? Why are they speaking Spanish? Whatever languages they had. Those weren't the ones mentioned. I'm just throwing that in for modern context. But why are they speaking something that I can understand? These men don't speak my language. And then suddenly it clicks. The wind, the fire, the speaking in their own language, suddenly God coming as a man and teaching us how to live, God taking on our sins, God coming as a man, dying on the cross for us, and then not only that, but defeating death and rising again. Suddenly it began to make sense to those hearing it, at least as much sense as that can to any earthly human. And what happened on that Easter Sunday, 50 days before, now the people realize that it mattered to us gathered here on Pentecost. Now it matters to us who are here in this place. 2,000 years later, we realize it matters to us as well. The Easter message can make sense because of the Pentecost experience, because of the coming of the Holy Spirit. Now, in my article, I wrote about children having a beginning band or a beginning orchestra. I wrote about the sounds that come out of that. One thing I didn't write about is the adult version. Maybe some of you have heard of a New Horizons band. In the early 1990s, a man by the name of Dr. Roy Ernst started a band for adults who wanted to begin and play a musical instrument, or for those who played years and years ago and wished to restart their joy of playing in music. And now you can find New Horizons bands all over the world. It's an international organization, and it has groups all over the world. Just out of curiosity, how many of you back in the day played an instrument? Anybody in here? A few of us? All right, so you played an instrument back in the day. Have you ever thought about pulling it out now? How many of you has it been like 20 years at least or more since you've actually picked it up and played it? Have you ever thought about what would I sound like if I pull that out and just play it today? What would I sound like if I try it again? I can give you the answer to it because I've done it too. You're not going to sound good, at least not right away. It's going to take some time to get those skills back, but they do come back. In the first New Horizons band, it was people who played back in the day and they wanted to play again, but it also involved new people. He had a man who was 89 years old beginning the clarinet. And he said after some time, he was able to learn it. He was able to play in the band along with everybody else. Now, I know what you're thinking. When it comes to music, when it comes to many things in life, some things are just best left in the closet, and some things are best left for the young. And yet, I don't know one person on this earth whose life isn't touched somehow by music. Even those who can't hear. I've met many who have degrees of deafness, and yet they like hearing, they'll hold on to a speaker or sit somewhere and they like feeling the beats and the vibrations and everything that music brings to us. One of the greatest composers to have ever lived, Ludwig van Beethoven, wrote his most famous symphony, Symphony No. 9, while he was completely deaf. It's one of the most beautiful pieces of work. If you sung Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, one of the hymns we have, that's the theme of part of that. It goes on for about an hour longer, but that's one of the main themes in that. There's something about music that just touches us all. That means that music isn't just for the young. There's something otherworldly that we get when we play music and when we hear music. It helps life feel more complete. How many of you, when a song from your youth comes on the radio, you can just remember where you were when you heard it? You remember something that happened in your life at that time. There's something about music that makes us feel more complete. So music is not just a gift for the young, just as Jesus is not just a gift for the young. Now, I'm not going to sugarcoat things for you. Life may not be just for the young, but we all have to admit it changes as we get older. Most of us in here can't move as fast as we used to. Our body makes creaks and rattles and sounds that it never used to when we just try to stand up. Doing some of those things that we did when we were younger just isn't as easy as it used to be. Maybe it's being athletic. I was talking to a man yesterday who spent all of his life, he wasn't exactly a bodybuilder, but he lifted weights and he wanted to be in shape all of his life. And he says, at 61, I just can't lift what I used to lift even in my 50s. It's not that he's gotten lazy because he's trained every day and on a regular schedule, but just getting older, things change. Sometimes, and I think we all can relate to this, just getting out of bed becomes almost a physical struggle. I'm told, here's how you know if you're old. You go to a chair and you sit down, and if you go, ugh. How many of y'all make that sound when you sit down or stand up? Okay, you get where I'm going with this. Getting older is not for the faint of heart. How many of us have looked in the mirror and asked a virgin, can these bones live again? I can't do what I did in my 20s. I can't do what I did in my 50s. Some of us, I can't do what I did in my 70s. But can these bones ever live again? Can I fit into those clothes ever again? Can I drive as far as I used to ever again? Can I just move my body without aches and pains again? I know we've asked that about our church before. Can these bones live again? Literally every church I have ever been part of or served, and probably for the rest of my career, probably will ever serve, are always going to ask the question, can these bones live again? But what are we really asking when we say, can these bones of our church live again? Often what we're saying is, can God breathe a new spirit in us, what we're asking is, what do we need to do to get back to the old days, to the good old days? Do I have any fans of The Office in here, the TV show The Office? There's a character in there by the name of Andy Bernard. And as the season was coming to a conclusion, he gives this really deep quote. He says, I wish there was a way to know that you're in the good old days before you've actually left them. I wish there was a way to know that you were in the good old days before you've actually left them. So when we ask, can these bones live again? We're often asking, can we get back to the good old days? I have an answer for that. Life moves forward. I've looked at the calendar. I've gone ahead. My phone has a calendar. I've even looked at the paper ones. Looking ahead, I can promise you without a sense of doubt that the year 1954 is never coming back. There is nothing we can do to get back to the good old days. The time is just not coming around. Though ironically, it's said of the church today that the church today is definitely prepared and ready to thrive if 1954 ever comes back. We are set to thrive if that day comes back. But guess what? 1954 is gone, and it's not coming back. Fill in that with whatever your golden year was. Can these bones live again? Well, if we're asking, can I get back to the good old days? The answer is no. That will never happen. But is that really what the Spirit of Pentecost is about? Is the Spirit of Pentecost getting back to some ideal that happened a long time ago? I'd argue it's not. You see, this doesn't mean that we're without hope because the good old days aren't coming back. In fact, it means just the opposite. We aren't without hope, we're forced to live on hope. We're forced to be people of hope. You see, years ago, long before the coming of Jesus, Israel was in exile. Babylon, which is roughly modern-day Iraq, came in, kidnapped many of the Israelites. They took them and brought them to Babylon. As they were living in Babylon for about 70 years, return seemed absolutely hopeless. In fact, life wasn't horrible. Oh, it wasn't what we wanted back home. It wasn't as good as it could have been, but we were taken and we were taken to a captive land and we could make the best of it, the Israelites were saying. In fact, many of them built their own new lives and got used to it. Sure, going back home is going to be a million times better than this, but we can make do here. In fact, what good would even come out of returning home at this point? It's been 70 years. Many of us don't even remember what life was like back home. And yet God said, I'm going to do a new thing. He talked through the prophet Ezekiel. And in chapter 37 of the book of Ezekiel, and I'm sure many of you know this passage, Ezekiel writes, "The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. This valley was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. And he said to me, 'Mortal, can these bones live?' And I answered, 'O Lord God, only you know.' And then he said to me, 'Prophesy to these bones. Say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you and you shall live. I will lay sinews in you and will cause your flesh to come upon you. And I will cover you with skin and I will put breath in you and you shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord.'" Have you ever been around a bunch of bones? Ezekiel was that day. A valley just full of dry bones, meaning that they've been dead a long time. Is God actually saying to Ezekiel, these bones are going to live again? That's exactly what God is saying. And so Ezekiel goes on and he says, "So I prophesied as I had commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come on them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them." Suddenly we see that God is at work and he's building things up and he's making them new. And then he said to me, God said to Ezekiel, he said, "Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain that they may live." And so Ezekiel prophesied as he had commanded me, and the breath came into them and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. When Israel was in exile, when everything seemed hopeless, when they actually made do with the way things were going, They said, can these bones live? And they made excuses. Oh, they can live here in exile. We can make life work out. But God's spirit had a different idea. God said, these bones are going to live. And it happened. Israel returned from the exile later on, and they rebuilt even stronger than they were before. On that first Easter morning, when everybody's wondering what, well, even right before they got to the tomb, they're going to anoint the body of this dead Jesus, the one that they put their hope in, the one who was crucified, the one who they thought was dead now forever. And yet God said to the world, these bones of Jesus will live. And they get to the tomb and they see that he's not there. And not only is he not there, he's been risen and he's appeared to them throughout the rest of the Gospels until they see him ascend into heaven. Not only did his bones live, but he brought more life into the world through giving us eternal life. On this first Pentecost that we read about, God said, these bones of your faith, this faith that you're trying to make sense to yourselves and to other people, this faith that doesn't make sense is going to live. And it happened. And the true meaning of life would be spread and understood that day as people were able to share in their own languages and understand in their own languages. But it didn't stop on Pentecost, at least that first Pentecost. Because today, God is telling us, God is telling this church, God is telling the churches around the world, these bones will live. And if we have the eyes to see, if we can click off the news for a little bit, if we can turn off the bad news givers who just try to do everything to dissuade us, we can see that there are signs of life happening all around us, and especially with and in us. I don't know what God's ultimate vision of our bones living, the bones of the church, the bones of our faith, the bones of the world, but God promises us that the bones will live. Are we bold enough to be like Ezekiel? God is calling on us to prophesy that these bones will live. That means we need to get rid of our doomsday and worry and fear. Scripture tells us that perfect love casts out all fear. We need to get rid of our fear and realize that God has a plan, even though we can't see it, even though it absolutely doesn't make sense, even though some of the signs are pointing to exactly the opposite. God is saying these bones will live. He sent His Son Jesus with us so we can live eternally. These bones will live through God's people as we serve and as we worship Him. These bones will live as the people of God cannot even imagine what God has in store for us. Will it look different than 1954? Absolutely it will. Will it look different from today? Absolutely it will. But God is saying these bones are going to live again. When all looks dead, God is at work bringing life. Church, can your bones live again? I hope you'll join me in saying, yes, these bones will live. Our closing hymn reminds us what it means to be the church, what it means to be the living bones, what it means to prophesy life. The title is, We Are the Church. If you use hymnals, it's number 558. Otherwise, you can find the lyrics on the screen. Please stand as we sing our closing hymn.
Thank you.
On that Pentecost, God showed us that we are the church, and yet we're to take that message and make the rest of the world the church. And so as we go from this place this morning, let the Spirit fill our hearts and minds that we can't help but spread the message of God's love through our actions and through our words. And now, may the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you all. Amen.